Everybody, welcome. I'm Pat Ogden, and I'm here today with Marie Damgaard. We wanted to talk about sexual assault because April is Sexual Assault Awareness Month, and Marie has a lot of experience working with sexual assault. So welcome, Marie.
Thanks, Pat. Good to be with you.
Yeah, same. So what do you think the most difficult part of working with sexual assault is? I know it's really challenging.
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. And I think that there are a couple of ways that we could look at this. Mm-hmm. It can be difficult for clients, and it can also be difficult for the clinician. Mm-hmm. So if we discuss what's difficult for clients, often many clients who come in to see me don't even recognize that they have experienced sexual assault.
Uh-huh.
And with that, there can be an erosion of self-confidence and a loss of who they once were. And, you know, sometimes there's this wishful thinking, right? Like once we talk about it, we should be done with it. And sometimes, you know, in sensory motor psychotherapy, we have to look at the same thing a few times, and that doesn't always, you know, feel good.
I find clients don't often realize that the root of their distress is really in the body.
Right.
Trauma has so impacted the body.
Right. Totally. Yeah. And I think that, if we talk about what's difficult for therapists, I mean, I think therapists can struggle being with the dysregulation and often want to take clients out of this experience because a lot of clinical and counseling training, you know, received has enforced this message to get the client out of dysregulation. And sensory motor psychotherapy offers a path to exploring the impact of sexual assault in a safe way. And you know, clients can experience healing in a contained space in the presence of a supportive relationship.
Do you think, I mean, you know, so many sexual assault survivors, it's such a painful injury for them. Like once they, well, in the cases that you're saying, once they acknowledge it, from a body perspective, what are your thoughts about that?
Yeah, I think from a somatic perspective, I think part of why sexual assault is such a painful injury is because it undermines the person's relationship with themselves through the somatic domain.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the violation and intrusion undermines the person's sense of agency through the relationship with their body.
Yeah.
And, you know, violation and intrusion is opposite of respect and dignity.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And people's bodies will respond in a certain way to that, even if they're not aware of it. They might pull in or, you know, mobilize, and all those postures will influence our well-being. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's rewarding, though, to work with this injury, isn't it? Like, you find it rewarding?
It is. It's really rewarding. And I think a couple of the most important aspects of this are reclaiming and presence. And mm-hmm. when I think about reclaiming, I often think of the principles holism and perhaps unity, right? Uh-huh. So that they don't uh-huh. have to keep part of themselves hidden or sequestered or fragmented in some way.
Yeah.
And, you know, a sense of being able to be present with their experience can lead to greater choice.
Yeah, I think often a sexual assault is, it induces that experience of, you know, that was then,
mm-hmm.
and then now everything after the assault. And mm-hmm. So when you say reclaiming, when I've worked with sexual assault too, I find clients reclaim that part of themselves that they feel they had lost through the trauma.
Right. Right.
Yeah, and they reclaim it in a real physical way. Like they start to live differently in their bodies.
Yeah. Hold themselves differently, right?
I'm sorry? They hold themselves differently. Yeah, that's right. There's a, I often have clinicians ask, I'm sure you do too, like, don't we have to really remember all the details of the injury? And have clients focus on all the details? What do you think about that? Well, how much or how little do you think clinicians should focus on the details?
That's a really good question. I think from a sensory motor psychotherapy perspective, you know, understanding the rationale and focusing on the details, we're not focusing on the details of narrative. right? We're focusing on the details in the body, which often reveals, you know, incomplete actions or interrupted defensive responses or this difficulty being present. And so it's not the details per se, but it's using the details to catalyze sensory motor interventions.
Yeah, I think of it that way too. It's like the memory is useful really to stimulate the responses in the body that are not complete. Somebody remembers that detail of assault, they still have the impulse to defend themselves, even though they weren't able to defend at the time, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I'll bet you have some memorable examples of your work with sexual assault.
Yeah, I think that with lots of memorable ones, you know, but what the pieces that sort of stick out for me that are really memorable is that I think people are surprised that this can get processed and that the body can metabolize these experiences.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I think about, you know, the as much as the body holds, it can also release, and that people can experience acts of triumph. And that does, I mean, it looks very different for each client, but I think that's what often really sticks out for me as memorable.
Yeah.
And it surprises clients too, and clinicians.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm thinking of one client that I worked with who was experienced a lot of sexual assault. Like, she'd been raped many, many times, and she'd been an alcoholic. And when she finally dealt with the alcoholism, then she came to therapy, and I did a consult with her. And when she found that defensive response, like, her hands kept going like this, you know, she was talking about the rape.
Yeah.
And so I held a pillow, and when she pushed, what really impressed me was that she really loved it. It really felt good to her.
Right.
What she said was, she said, "This feels like hope."
Oh,
And I think that's true with the body. When those actions get executed again, a client can feel, or executed as you're reworking the memory, clients feel like there's hope for the efficacy of that action, even though it was not advisable in the past because it wouldn't have been effective, you know?
Yeah, and I think this ties in, Pat, to some of the things that a lot of sexual assault survivors continue to work on, right? They often continue to work on trusting their body and renegotiating their relationship with their body. And in the sensory motor sense, this could show up in resourcing or how the memory is processed or those relational aspects that you mentioned during or after the experience.
Yeah.
And as it shows up in many of these places, part of the common thread that pops up for me is this trusting self and the body.
Mm-hmm.
And in this is also this renegotiation that shows up with physical pleasure. You know, that often is a big piece of this work as well.
And,
you know, as we mentioned, you know, a couple times already, from a sensory motor perspective, we might revisit things more than once because they reveal different aspects each time we move through them.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we do revisit the ones for sure. I mean, when I listen to you talking, I you know, like, pleasure and agency and empowerment and all these intentions that we would like our clients to get to those places.
Right.
And I in the sensory motor work, you know, all of that is embodied.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to feel empowered if your body's collapsed.
Right.
Or it's hard to feel, you know, pleasure if you have all these blocks and the energy can't flow freely in your body, you know. So we really do look at helping people live differently in their bodies, huh?
That's... Yeah, absolutely. And I think about some of the ways that are things that get, you know, or interfere with people's healing from an SP perspective is people get stuck and bodies get stuck.
Yeah.
And sometimes what happens is they keep expecting the same bad outcomes even though the content is different.
Yeah.
They need an experience to get them out of that cycle. You know, just talking about it does not provide them an experience.
And so,
you know, I just think about shame and how the body holds shame and how people can get pulled into these dynamics. And it's sort of you know, not, you know, they are inadvertently, you know, getting caught up in this old dynamic. It's not intentional. It's not a fault. It's really, you know, an enactment in a sense with no completion and sort of the same rabbit hole every time.
Yeah. And the body can often take us there, like, you know, the posture of shame, often, you know, pulled in a kind of hiding posture.
Yeah.
Could work with that shame forever, but until their body shifts.
Yeah.
The body will keep expecting kind of the same interactions, the same emotions. Yeah.
And there's a heaviness to it too, right?
Mm-hmm. Like it takes absolutely.
Sort of even get that spine aligned again and and holding it differently.
Yep. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what words of encouragement would you have to survivors of sexual assault who might be watching?
You know, I did not feel this way until I found sensory motor psychotherapy around sexual assault. But what I would say is what happened to you does not need to impede or dictate or control your life. And it's workable. Mm-hmm. You know, that, you know, sensory motor psychotherapy provides this sense of relationship and aftercare. And I think this makes sense, especially if people have been sexually assaulted by, you know, someone who they know or in a family system, and there's no aftercare there, right?
Yeah.
This work allows us to meet their needs and the body needs. And I think there is healing in that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, thanks so much for participating. Lovely talking with you.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing, Pat.
Yeah. All right. Okay.